Have a gift for all the fathers that are here today. They want to make sure you get before you leave this morning. So we just want to say thank you to all of you that have come to be a part of our fellowship today. And, it's been a little different service this morning, but that's okay. But we just want you to know today that we love you. That's what really today is all about. You know, a lot of times we fail to tell people and to show them often enough. When I say we, I'm talking about every one of us in this room. We fail to let those that are around us know how much we appreciate them. And I think one of the places we need to begin this morning, because I look around and I realize there are several of you in here that have brought things today. And I realize that wasn't easy. It wasn't easy for some of you guys to get up and load tractors, you know, bring race cars, bring trucks, and all of that stuff that you did over here this morning. But we just want to say thank you this morning for being here. Theme was kind of about treasures, and we just wanted to provide some of those things that we guys look at and identify as treasures. We call them boy toys, and you know, a lot of the things that we possess in our life, even though some of them, my Lord, I looked out there and I saw a car out there this morning, and I prayed real hard when I saw that 55 Chevy out there, and I said, "Now, God, I don't want to covet in this church property today." And I saw those pickups when they back in over there, and I saw some of this other stuff, and I thought, "My Lord, help me now, Lord." I don't want to have the wrong spirit. I don't want theirs, but it'd be really nice to have one like that. Amen. But we enjoy looking at those things, and it's kind of a guy thing. It's kind of like taking a lady to the mall, turning her loose. You carry us guys and put us somewhere like that where they got stuff we can put our hands on and figure out the mechanisms and how it works. And it's just a great privilege. Me and my family had the privilege this weekend of going up to Mount Airy. So if Justin's talking a little funny today, he's been doing his Barney Five impressions all weekend. You missed that on Snapchat. I challenge you, go look it up. It'll be well worth it. He's about nipping us all in the bud, I can tell you that. At any rate, we had a good time. We had a wonderful time of just fellowship with my family. But God done something. I tell you guys all the time. I tell you all the time that when you're walking with God, every step you take is a spiritual thing.
Amen.
You agree with me?
Amen.
Because the Word of God says the steps of a good man. Now, none of us are good in our own merit. Okay, let me identify that first. I want to tell you, righteousness flows from the Father.
Yes.
But the beauty of God, He can take a wretched sinner like me. He can transform my heart. And He can rejuvenate that He put in me, which is His own image.
Amen.
And He can bring a likeness out of this rusty old guy that I am, that is a resemblance of Him.
Amen.
That is a miracle within itself. But I tell you oftentimes that every step we take is a spiritual step, because God is wanting to show you something He's wanting to pour into you for one of two reasons, either to bless you or to pour into you so he can pour that out at you at a later date. But everything we do is, it takes on spiritual applications. And I'm going to be sharing a little bit with you here in a few moments today during this message about the treasures of life. I kind of had a feeling yesterday, like Paul said. I can't really tell you whether I was in the body or out of the body. I don't know that I've ever experienced an awakening through the eyes of God like I had yesterday in a campground called Home Place of All Places. When we backed our campers in, there was the most beautiful setting I've ever seen in my life for me. There's a little mountain brook coming down, feeding over a pond, running over the rocks behind us. Our campers were elevated up over that. Behind that, off in the background, was just a beautiful swimming pool. I don't know how big that pool was. It was the most magnificent pool I've ever seen in my life. It wasn't really about the pool to me because it just, you know, was what it was. But my camper was sitting right here, and this is where I was sitting in this chair, and this brook was flowing there before me and the pool out behind us, and that doesn't do it justice. That pool just went on and on and on and on. Probably, I don't know, they said it cost $10,000 to paint the pool, if that gives you any idea how large this pool was. It was enormous. God gave me a vision here yesterday. And as I sat there, he began to open my eyes to some things. And I'm going to be sharing with you this morning. For several weeks now, God had given me the scripture, and I'd been preparing my heart about treasures, but you guys know how I am about visuals and showing you things. As I said, I don't know whether I was in the body or out of the body. My wife was in the camper tidying up things because we were going to leave last night so we could be back this morning. Thank you, Justin and Katie, for getting up at 6:30 this morning, driving home, being with us at church. Thank you, Father. And I was sitting here in this chair, and all of a sudden, I had this image. Now, you guys are not going to be able to make this out. It doesn't matter. Let's go back to that picture. Here's my family. All my family, but me and Tammy, are over yonder. They're around the pool. I've been sitting there for hours watching my grandbaby playing in the water. We had been over there with them, but the old folks wear out. Anybody say amen?
Amen.
So I come back and made it back to the chair, and all of a sudden I looked out and I saw my family. And God began to speak into my heart. This is what he said. I sat on my throne as you sit here today, and I look at the world in front of me that means so much to me. Created in my own image. I looked out and I saw my bloodlines. Now, they were busy. They had been in the swimming pool, playing with the kids, chasing Berkeley. Now, you know why Papa's going back to the chair. They were not even aware, Bruce, that I was overlooking them. They were not even aware that I was guarding them. God began to speak to my heart and said, this is what I see every day. When I look down on a world that is busy going and doing all the things that I have created for them to do. And so many times, they're not even aware that I'm there. But I've always got my eye on them. They were playing. They were watching. There was one time, Brother Jimmy, that I sat in there in that chair, and Berkeley had got something, and she was out on the outside of the pool, and Justin was sitting there on the edge, and Katie was here on this side of her, and Aunt Amanda was here, and they were, all of them's eyes was focused on something else, and I'm sitting there, and I'm thinking, get your eyes back on that baby. Get your eyes back on that baby. Make sure you get your eyes back on that baby. When they got their eyes back on that baby. But God began to speak to my heart and says, I want you to experience what I feel every day. But the world about us is so busy with the treasures of this present life that I have created for them to enjoy. And then all of a sudden, God began to speak to me, and He said, before my throne is a river that runs crystal clear. Now, guys, this picture in no way does this little creek, this little spillway. That water was rushing through there, but it was so crystal clear you could see the pebbles laying on the bottom. It was two little boys that had been playing in this brook behind me as I was overviewing, and all of a sudden I heard the father say, suffer the little children to come unto me. They were in this brook, and they had those rubber flip-flops. Y'all know what I'm talking about? And they'd turn them loose, and the water would take them down. And those little boys would run down after them. Well, after a while, they'd get hung on the rocks. They'd catch them. Just doing what boys do. And after a while, one of the flip-flops took off. And the bigger boy, probably about 8 years old, he said, oh, my flip-flop. I got to get my flip-flop. He jumps out on the hill, and he runs down. And I thought about it. I didn't know when. And I heard God say, my hand of protection. Did you hear what I just said? Didn't have a clue. But they'd been playing on the other side in the big grassy area between that water and the pool. And I heard God say, my hand of protection. For some reason, he jumped up here on the rocky side and went run down and back in the water and back up on the rocks. And he finally got his flip-flop. And he comes back out, I don't know, maybe 40 yards down the stream. And as he's running back along there, as little boys do, looking and throwing rocks and doing what boys do, I seen him as he jumped back. Darren, I want to take you to the next picture there. Guys, you probably will see it. Now, I want to tell you this little stick right here, the little boy throwed the rock and throwed it down there trying to scare this snake. By the way, this was water moccasin. Yeah. And the boys have been playing right there in that stream. And all of a sudden, God's voice that I heard him say, my protection, made sense. That little boy had jumped up on those rocks on the opposite side of that water where they had been playing and run down that stream. Little boy jumped back, went on around. Of course, the rest of my focus is on this. But during this process, I heard God as he was speaking to me. He said, here I am. There's a river of life that flows before my throne, crystal clear. But there's a serpent that lies between my children where I am. He's there to keep them from this river that loves. Uses a lot of things, guys. We talk about treasures, and we wanted to bring them out in the yard today for you to look at. You know, fire trucks out there. What little boy don't love a fire truck? What big guy don't love a fire truck? Cars and motorcycles and boats. Campers, and to be honest with you, that's my wife's treasure. I just get to go along with it. The ultimacy of being able to enjoy the things that God created. Dear Heavenly Father, as we open our hearts for the next few moments, we ask God that you would minister to us that is needed this morning. Open our mind, open our hearts, let us give you our undivided attention for just a few moments. In Jesus' name we pray. You see, we live in a world which is measured by size of one's wealth and possessions, by one's accomplishments and by one's fame, by their degrees that hang on the wall, or the talents they possess in the power of man. Regrettably, Christianity and Christians are also often tempted to view success in terms of these temporary and temporal things. They forget that whereas fame, education, wealth, beauty, athletic power, and value, such things will be lost one day. But there are some things that endure for value without hesitation. Such things as compassion and love and generosity and kindness and sympathy and humility. You see, the Bible says these virtues not only measure the greatness of a person, but they also reveal who a person really is. We call these virtues or characteristic traits. According to our Lord Jesus Christ, those are the treasures that really count. I was telling a story out there earlier today as I looked at that 55 Chevy. Man, did that car belong to anybody in this building? I don't know if they left or not. But I'm telling you right now, it's a beautiful automobile. There's some beautiful vehicles out there. And as we looked at those treasures that were out there this morning, just a handful of things, some race cars that these young guys, man, that's pretty neat to be that age right there driving that race car. I wish y'all could have seen that guy's face. I started saying little guy, but he ain't a little guy. I wish y'all could have seen his face this morning when I told him, I said, listen, if you got this car headed in the wrong direction, I just run it down the Highway 13, spin it around, bring it back. That way it'll be headed the right direction. He looked at me like, which rock do you want to go ahead? I think he's planning on turning me loose in his race car. Those are gifts to be able to enjoy. They're possessions that we hold great value to. But God's going to tell you, every one of those things that was out there in that yard, they're going to pass away. I was telling a little story earlier. There was a 57 Chevrolet, two-door, hardtop. It used to sit on the end of the road. I stopped and asked the guy about buying it before he died, years before he died, Mr. Man. He told me I didn't have enough money to buy it. I guess he was right, because I didn't ever buy it. But when he died, the Chevrolet sat on it, was laying on top of it. Every vehicle out there in that yard today, every prized possession has its end somewhere.
Amen.
But your soul is going to live forever.
Amen.
You go as far as you can go in your mind process, and you sit down and rest a while and get up the next day and go on further. And when you've done that as many days as you know how to do it, I want to tell you, eternity still got a ways to go. Never has no end to it. You and I can't wrap our minds around something without end, because everything we've ever known came to an end. But I want to challenge you today by reminding you of just a few things here in the house of the Lord today. And I want to do that by taking you to Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 through 21, where we're going to find this verse of Scripture, and it says, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. Listen now, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also."
Amen.
You see, they are treasures, and your treasures determine your priorities. They reveal your true ambitions, your attractions, and your affections. You see, the decisive question today is, are the things you presently treasure, what are they, and what do they really mean? Ultimately, do they have a lasting value? Treasures is where our heart is. I've often said you can take a guy's checkbook and you can pretty well tell where his heart is, where he's spending his money, what his attributes are. Now, I promise you, if you look in my wife's checkbook, you're going to find out our grandbabies is who we love. We used to love our young ones, but that's changed now. They just jump right on over them. Me and Justin now, Mama, Meemaw, goes to town, and me and Justin used to get excited when they come home, because me and Justin used to get something. We don't even get up no more. We ain't even getting up. We love them. You see, however, in verse 19, Matthew chapter 6, and running through the remainder of the chapter, Jesus shifts his focus on this sermon to value what we hold in life. He explains that worldly value are as dangerous as religious hypocrisy. For unless the objects of our lives, our treasures as we call them, are based on eternal realities, we stand in risk of losing everything.
Amen.
Our Lord makes this point in the following verses that I just read to you, and how that we lay not up for ourselves treasures upon the earth, where moth and rust can corrupt, but and thieves may break in and steal, but that we lay up our treasures in heaven where these things can no longer be taken from us.
Amen.
You see, we must consider today the value of our treasure. And I want to begin that today with establishing some thoughts about treasures. Everybody in this building has treasures.
Amen.
Now some of you say, well, preacher, how can that be? I didn't have a fancy car to bring. I didn't have a big tractor to bring. I thought about bringing my tractor, and I'm so glad I did. I mean, talk about overkill, why don't you? It's okay. I'm out parking my little camper over there, and Justin comes in with his mobile home. That's why I put him on the end so y'all can still see mine. What are treasures? Treasures are things we hold value to. The implication is that everyone has some treasures. Even the poor have treasures. You see, the reason Christ did not exclude anyone from the matter of treasures is because treasures consist more in the affections of the heart than in what one can hold in their hands. Thus, every human being, regardless of their age, their stature, their gender, their education, their background, even those that feel like they have nothing have treasures. You ever seen a homeless guy coming down the street? He's got his treasures. He'd be pushing a shopping cart with one of the wheels banging around on it. He's got everything that he treasures in that shopping cart. Doesn't matter who you are or where you're at in life, we all have treasures. And there's not anything wrong with possession. Not anything wrong. You see, I've heard many people say, oh, you just got to be poor to love Jesus. I don't believe that. You know what God said about His plans for you? God said His plans for you was to prosper you. That's the very first thing He said. Then He went on and He added a lot of other blessings. But I want you to understand today, broke people can't fund the kingdom of God. It don't matter how much you want to give. If you ain't got nothing to give, you can't give nothing. I've been there. Amen? But the Bible also says to those that have much, much is required. Amen. It's not ours. It's just been given on loan to us. What's that? To be a blessing to those that are about us. Now, what are treasures? Treasures may be tangible or intangible. They can be held in the hand or simply stored in the mind. A treasure is that upon which you place your affections and your attention. It may be your money, your possessions, your reputation, your honor, your praise, your relationship, your degree, or your time. I remember when I was 14 years old, my daddy was taking me to town to get my first public job. You notice I said my first public job. I had been slaved out up until that point. Y'all laugh. I borrowed tobacco for 3 years before Uncle Sam. Not the governor, Uncle Sam, my Uncle Sam. I bartered back with him for 3 years before I knew you got paid to do it.
That's right.
I thought you eat a biscuit to do it. That's what I done. When his youngins eat, I eat. I mean, in the summertime, school got out. JP would come pick me up. That was my cousin. He'd take me to Uncle Sam's house. That's where I stayed. When his boys got a whipping, I got a whipping. When they got a biscuit, I got a biscuit. When they got up and took out a barnabacker, I got up and took out a barnabacker. All the hired hands went home, and I still was there getting hollered at. One Saturday, I don't know what happened, but one Saturday afternoon, he had brought in some extra help. We had got behind. It had been a rainy season. He didn't normally do this, but he came out to the field that evening and he had envelopes and he was handing them out. I looked at my cousin Dale, I said, what's in the envelope? He said, that's to pay. I said, we get paid to do this? I went home, I said, Daddy, nobody told me we got paid to do this. He said, you don't, boy. I realized then I was a slave. Y'all like it? He carried me to town, he said, hey, you're going to get your first public job. I was excited, thinking, we're going to the bank. I'm going to be a banker. We went to Piggly Wiggly. I was a bag boy. And on the way, that 3-mile journey, this is what he said to me. He said, son, you don't have cows. You don't have race cars. You don't have big tractors. You don't have fast motorcycles. You don't have cattle. You don't have farmland. He didn't name all those names. He said, you don't have land and you don't have cows to fall back on. said, but the one thing I have given you, I'm giving you today, and that's a good name in this county. When we got there, I thought he was going to drop me off at the door. He went in. He walked up to Mr. Bobby Sunray, shook his hand. He said, Mr. Bobby, I want to thank you for giving my boy a job, giving him this opportunity. If he don't do what you need him to do, you can call me before the fire. Exactly what he said. Then he turned and looked at me and said, you better do what he tells you to do. And when he turned and walked off, I said, Mr. Bobby, what you need to do? Is that the way it went then? He said, now son, today I've given you a name. He said, but it's up to you what you do with that name. He said, I can walk into any business in this county, walk in the front door and tell them what I need, and I can go home with it without any money. Mm-hmm. He proved that to me. Me and her decided we wanted to snatch us a 45-foot single-wide trailer out of a field. Pull it home with a tractor. Set it up in a field. That's what we done. I walked in the bank. I had a little money I'd save. You don't save a lot of money back in groceries. He'd been there too. We set that trailer up out there in the field, but when I went in that bank and told the man how much money I need, Raymond Smith looked at him and he said, Mr. Rod, his name was Rod Burks. He said, Mr. Rod, he said, that's my boy and he's good for it. He shook his hand, turned around and walked out. Scared to death. Mr. Rod Burger stood up and said, son, said, you rang a son? And I said, yes, sir. He said, you're good for it. That's enough for me. How much do you need? That's what he told me. That's the way we've done business back here.
That's right.
He gave me a good name. It's a treasure. I want you to understand today it was a treasure. No, it won't black and shiny like that beautiful car. Man, it didn't roll smoke like that tractor. It didn't thunder the windows on my camper like that race car. Mind you, but it was a treasure. What is that treasure? What does it look like today? What is the value of your treasure today? Thirdly, you see, Jesus didn't oppose treasure. Sometimes we get things all bent out of shape. We think God don't want us to have nothing.
That's right.
Folks, I want to tell you something. God wants you to have something. When Jesus said, lay not up your treasures upon the earth, does it mean that it's wrong for Christians to own or possess things in this world? Jesus is not condemning possessions or ownership or even enjoying what God has provided for you in your life.
That's right.
I want to say that again. God don't mind you having stuff.
Amen.
Look at 1 Timothy chapter 5 and verse 8 before some of you want to argue with me. If anyone does not provide for his relatives and especially for those in his immediate family, he has denied the faith and is worse than even an unbeliever. Guys, I want you to understand, God don't mind you having something. You ain't got to be poor to worship God. You just got to worship God with all that is within you. God don't care whether you got $5 or $50,000. He's interested in what you're going to do with either one of them. Does it belong to Him or does it belong to you? Are you only willing to provide for yourself or are you willing to say, God, it's yours. Everything I got belongs to you and I ain't got to keep none of it. It's up to you, God. Amen. You see, I come today just to celebrate with you about the treasures of life, but we need to understand it's okay for us to have some stuff. Then I want you to understand the treasure's not the treasure. Hello? Jesus warned against the preoccupation with anything that can be destroyed. We must not treasure anything that would not value for eternity.
Amen.
It's all right to have these things, but it can't be our God. Amen?
Amen.
Now, that's not, that. Listen, ain't nothing wrong with taking care of what you've got.
Amen.
But it's not our God.
That's right.
Because all these things that we possess can be taken away from us in a moment of time.
Yes.
And ultimately, it doesn't matter what we've got, if we come down to the last of our road, none of that stuff is going to matter anyhow. The only thing that is going to matter is where your heart is in God. He is your treasure. You see, this is brought into light by Christ's reference to moss and rust and thieves. You see, the Bible times wealth was stored and measured by how much literally the commodities a person owned. Even the number of wives they had determined their wealth. Amen. Aren't you glad we outgrew that one, guys? You can lose your wealth and your talent and your health overnight. The significance in a person's life today can be an idol. Do we idolize those things? Are they more important to us than God? And then the treasure, the treasure. Listen now. You see, the kind of treasure, the treasure is determined by the ultimate destiny. Notice that Jesus explained only two destinies for the treasures, on earth and in heaven. Are we taking it to heaven? If not, then it's just something that's been entrusted to us for us to enjoy here on this earth. Don't mean we're not supposed to take care of it. But it's not our Lord. It's not our God. You see, the treasure laid up in heaven is imperishable. No fire, no flood can destroy it. Not a thief can take it. No moth, no rust can corrupt it. For it is being kept by God. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 17, 18, 19. It says, command those things who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so unclean, but to put their hope in God. Are you hearing me this morning? Amen. If our hope is in anything else other than God, we're laying up treasures in a place that will not hold back. Who richly provides for us with everything for our enjoyment. But yet people say, oh, you can't have nothing and serve God. Read the Bible. Amen. God says they've been given to us for our enjoyment. Amen. Yeah, amen. It's okay for you to fire up that tractor and blow smoke higher than the trees. Yeah. Enjoy it. Amen. But it can't be our God. Amen. Amen. It doesn't matter what we possess in this life. Does it belong to God? Amen. Amen. I got a good friend that owns a beautiful place down at the beach. Beautiful, two-story house. She let me and my wife go there and stay in it. You know what she told me? I said, ma'am, I ain't going to stay in your house. She said, oh, yes, you are. I said, ma'am, I'm not going to stay in your house. If I call her name, y'all know who she was. I ain't going to call her name, but I ain't want you calling her. Hey, I'm going to stay in your house. If God moves so accordingly on her heart, she's going to call you. Amen. She's going to give you the key to it. She's going to say, go down there and treat it like it's yours. And that's what I did. Because she said, let me tell you something God gave me, Dad. And God, I was going to sell that thing after my husband passed away. She said, but you know what? She said, God spoke to my heart and said, no, you don't do it, because I'm going to use it for my glory.
Amen.
And for your benefit. You see, we think everything we got just got to be for the glory of God and not for our benefit. Hogwash. God said, I created this so you could enjoy it. Amen. You got to have it in right perspective. He can't become your God. If it becomes your God, God will let you have it. Amen. You know what I ask God for every day? I want everything, God, that I can keep in right perspective. That's what I want. Because I want to be able to use it, God, for your glory.
Amen.
Not for mine. I want to use it, God, for your glory. If I can't use it for your glory, then God, I don't need it. Amen. I don't want no part of it.
Right.
He said, command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share.
Amen.
Hello? You know what the Bible said? The Bible said, how can I say I'm of God and I see my brother in need and I shed up my vows of compassion?
Hallelujah.
Oh, my Lord. Now, you got to be careful what you put your treasures in, because that'll be the very thing God will require out of you.
Amen. That's right.
You get idolizing that thing and it won't be long you have it on the market if you're going to be obedient to God. Amen. Now, wait a minute before some of you get scared, slammed to death. Abraham didn't have to kill Isaac, he just had to get ready to kill him. He just had to be willing to do it. And if you think he got that way in a minute, just go read the text. It took him about 3 days to get there. He carried folks pretty far as he could carry them. He said, now y'all wait right here. He said, me and the lad going to go down and worship God, and we coming back. He already had his mind made up then. He said, we coming back. I heard one man say, no, he just ain't got with it. He planned on going over there and bringing the old boy back with him. Well, he did. That's exactly what God granted him to do. You know all he had to do? He had to get with it. He had to tie him up, put him on the altar. But when he was completely committed to God, there was a rain to come.
Amen.
See, God don't want what you've got. God wants you to be willing to give it to him.
That's That's right.
I don't need what me and you got.
Amen.
Who are we? Well, bless God, I put my money in that offering. You ain't done jack.
That's right.
Oh, man, I know, say it. You like that, brother? It ain't yours to start with. Don't stand here and tell me what all you've done for God. You ain't done nothing except this right here. Took the air in that he provided for you. That's all you've done for him. Receive that he give you, and the abundance thereof as it goes on and on and on. Amen. I'm trying to hurry, and I'm fixing to shut down right now. It's fine. You see, the heart follows treasures. You see, the most powerful reason that Jesus declared the storing up treasures in heaven that is found in verse 21, he indicates that where your treasure is, there will be your heart. You see, God is always on the heart matter of things. He don't care about what you've got. You know what he cares about? He cares about that brook that is running between you and him.
Amen.
Because he knows if he can get you to that brook.
Yeah.
Now you listen to me. There's an obstacle laying by that brook.
Yes.
And the Bible says he's seeking whom he may devour.
Right.
Now y'all don't tell nobody. We're only putting it out on the World Wide Web, right? So I'm not going to tell anybody. But a certain guy, they said that snake attacked the campers. All I know is I got a burn place on my finger where he turned the grill over. That's a story for a different time. But the guy told me after the snake was no longer living, that it was against the law to kill snakes in that area. I didn't kill him now, but I wished him dead. Him dead. I don't believe it thundered up there last night. The man said, hey. In this way, they will lay up treasures for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age. Did you hear that?
Amen.
For the coming age. Mm-hmm. You see, guys, all we're interested in is the right now. What I got right now. But there's an eternity out there before us that God's going to say what you got now.
Yes.
And there's only one ticket. And his name is Jesus Christ.
Yes.
And he says, whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. He said that somebody might be saved. He could be saved. He possibly will be saved. No, the Bible said if you call on him, he'll save you.
Yes.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
That's what he's going to do. He's going to save you. Why? Because the heart follows the treasures. Wherever your treasure is, that's where your heart's going to be.
Amen.
Now listen to this. So choose your treasure wisely. Jesus twice urged us to lay up our treasures and then to reflectively pronounce yourself implies a choice at a personal level. Let's hear what he said. Lay up for yourself. See, God said it's about me. It ain't about what Kevin's got. No, he's got some pretty cool stuff. I'm going to sit there and walk out and say, Kevin got a lot of toys, ain't he? I said, no, Candace does. Matthew 6:33, listen to this. Every one of you here pray. But see first his kingdom and his righteousness. And all these things will be given to you. As well. You know what God wants you to do? He wants you to seek him first. He wants you to put him first.
That's right.
And all this other stuff that comes along in life, there's no telling what God will let you have if you get your priorities in life. Oh, he's preaching one of them prosperity messages. I'm preaching just what the Lord laid on my heart. Y'all take it any way you want to take it. You know what I believe God will give you? I believe God will give you everything you have. Because you know what His Word said? God's Word said it's His good pleasure to give you the kingdom.
Amen.
You know the reason why so many of us don't get the kingdom? Because we can't handle it. We don't keep it in perspective. Amen. want to ask if you would stand to your feet this morning. I know these have been scattered words, and I just asked today that, Darren, will you pull those pictures back up? We're going to close here this morning. Here's my family, guys. They're over there, they're not paying me no attention. They don't even know I'm watching, but I'm watching. Let's go to the next picture, Darren. I've got an overview looking down from the place that I was sitting, and you can't tell it by this picture. And this building sitting up on top was the rise of the other mountain, but the valley, and all this was down before us. I'm sitting as if I was looking down on all of creation. And there God began to speak to me. And he said, this is what I've offered people. Crystal clear forgiveness. The Bible said there is a throne that is flowing. And he says, whosoever will come into me. What I want to tell you is, guys, don't matter where you've been or what you've done, God loves you today. He wants to forgive you of your sins. There's an end. One more, Darren. And he's lying in wait for you. And he's learning. You know what the Bible said? The Bible said in one text, he crunches down. What's amazing is, I'm overviewing all of this. And I'm sick. Now, hypothetically speaking, there was a fence there. There was a road for them guys to come around my family. But what if they were leaving where they were at, coming straight to me? What was lying between them and the blessing of God was that was sent to devour. Could it be today, guys, that we're putting our treasures on things that the enemy has allowed us to have? How many of y'all believe the devil will give you stuff just as well as God? See, I want to tell you something. There's some things come your way that you don't need. Hello. You know what? I've seen people that God begin to bless them. I'm talking about people that have been low and have been faithful to God. And then all of a sudden the blessings of this life started coming to them. And the next thing you know, they didn't even know who God was. I understand there was a guy here in North Carolina. I don't know if any of y'all know him yet. If you know him, you probably already called him. But I understand he won about $340-some million.
He won't answer the phone.
I don't know the gentleman, but they asked him a question, and I heard his response. He said, what you going to do different? I thought about you, Bruce. You see, Bruce has got two pair of boots. He got a pair he works in and a pair he wears to church. When the pair he works in wears out, he takes his church boots and he goes to work in them and he buys him a pair of church boots. The way he works. He'll complain for about a month and a half after he buys him new church boots because they kill him. After that, he don't pay no attention to him. This guy that won this money, he said, I'm going to be the same guy next week. I don't know the guy. I'm just telling you what he said. He said, I wore blue jeans last week. And he said, next week, I'm going to wear blue jeans. And he said, now mind you, they may be new ones. I guess there's nothing wrong with that. I said all that to say to you today. There's a God in heaven, and he treasures you. You realize you are his treasure. But how many of us are busy going on with our lives? We're not paying him any attention. Now let me tell you one last little story. That little guy that went down the waterway there and got his flip pop out. When he come back along that edge, at this point I haven't even seen the state. And when he's coming along that edge, all of a sudden, thank God, the little boy saw the snake. And he jumped back. And when he jumped back, I had my shades on. I took them off. I got my pipe open. I seen the snake. And I'm about as far as from here to the front door to church, actually from the snake, and I moved back. But listen, little boy went all the way up the grass line to the fence and come back around. And in just a few moments, I saw his dad. Wake up, daddy. have it in your pocket.
Yes.
He's waiting this morning for you to go get him.
Amen.
He's waiting for you to say, I need you.
Yes.
I don't know where you're at today. It don't matter to me how big or how strong you are today. That means nothing. No matter today what you own, it don't matter how much you got in your pocket, because God loves you all the same. It don't matter where you've been, the difficulties you may have faced in this present life, there's a God in heaven that loves you. He's called our Heavenly Father. And He's waiting. He's waiting. You know, the interesting thing about that was that daddy went down there and up in them youngest's business. He was letting them boys be boys. But just as soon as they needed him, he was on the scene. I don't know the guy's name. Met him, just spoke with him very briefly. But I want to tell you something. He'd have laid down his life. Daddy's down here. I'm sitting over here on the other side observing all this. The guy looking up at me. I'm looking down at him. He's looking at me and I'm looking down at him. I'm directing him. That little boy was a long way off. You see, I can see all things. That man, he couldn't see that he knew he was facing. I thought about that's what it looks like sometimes would be.
Yes.
And I glance up at the Father and He's directing me.
Yes.
Right where I need to be going. You're in this building today, He's waiting. He's there and He's waiting on you to say, God, I need you. Would you direct me?
Yeah.
I want to say Happy Father's Day to you, but I want to say it to you like this. There's a Father in heaven that loves you for the love that you can't even imagine. As much love as that daddy had for that little boy, I want to tell you there's a God that is overseeing that child. Yeah, when there was one thing daddy could do about it because he wasn't even aware of the circumstances, there was a God that instructed that little 8-year-old boy to get out on the other side of the river. You believe whatever you want to believe. I believe God directed that little boy's footsteps. Tell me why. The only time in almost an hour I sat there and watched them boys, I see him get out on that side of the creek. When he got right where that snake was. None of us. I didn't know. Because I'm a mortal man sitting up on a hillside just overlooking everything else like you are. I think I know, but there was a God in heaven that did. Heavenly Father, I don't know everybody that is before me this morning. I don't know the place that they're at. I can look at their face and think to myself, man, he or she's got it all together. Look at that smile on their face. But ultimately, God, they may be dying inside. If there's one in this building this morning, God, that don't know you as their Heavenly Father, maybe they're here this morning. They came for whatever reason. Maybe somebody invited them just to come and look at some big boy toys. And maybe they just come to bring a toy to be shown off today. Whatever the reason they're here, I believe, God, they've got a divine appointment with you right now. Regardless of who we are and what our name is, I believe you know us by our name. And I believe you're directing our steps and you're ordering our ways. But you patiently wait and see if we'll call upon you. Is anybody in this building this morning that would say, you know what, preacher? I got some treasures on this earth. But I don't want anything to be more important to me than the God that created me. There's anyone in this building this morning that feels the need to pray? One's already moved. I just encourage you to come on. See, you don't have to wait on nobody. They already moved this morning. There's another moving. Right now, just come on and join them right around this altar. If you feel the need to pray, would you just step out this morning and make it?